Very good evening, everyone. A warm welcome from Bombay Natural History Society. So today for this webinar, I would first likely introduce our speaker, Dr. Rahul Mongikar, sir. He is assistant director of a policy cell working with BNHS since 2017. He has completed MSc in botany from University of Pune, and he was also a senior consultant for Maharashtra State Biodiversity Board, where he helped in implementation of Biodiversity Act 2002, and he also has experience in 500 plus lectures he has conducted on a subject related to People's Biodiversity Register. I warmly welcome Dr. Rahul Mongikar, sir. Now, for all of our participants, I would like to introduce in brief about our organization, Bombay Natural History Society. Sir, first slide, please. So, Bombay Natural History Society, or BNHS in short, was founded in 1883. It is a largest NGO which is engaged in conservation and biodiversity research sector. The photograph which we are all seeing right now is our headquarters, which is called Hornbill House, and is situated in Fort area of Mumbai. Next slide, please. Secondly, I would like to introduce you to the Conservation Education Center, CEC, which is situated in the Goregaon Film City. It works towards creating awareness about nature among various persons, like students from various schools, government employees, and also general people. It has also diverse activities like nature trails and workshop. Next slide, please. And it also conducts various certificate courses in biodiversity study. These are the courses. So you can visit CEC BNHS site for more details. Previous slide, sir, please. Now, regarding the environmental information system, it was founded in 1996 and is supported by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. The main focus or the objective is to create various data banks on bird and related areas. We also publish and distribute Buceros, which is a free and informative newsletter. Also, we provide data banks on website by using internet and provide bird related knowledge to the world. Also, NVIS conducts various green skill development programs under Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. Now I would like to hand over this session to Dr. Rahul Mongikar, sir. Sir, please continue the session.
Thank you, Viraj, thank you for my introduction. Good evening, everyone. Today, as you said, that it is a session is regarding the understanding the Biological Diversity Act and PBR. The more focus, no doubt, it will be on the People's Biodiversity Register. But so many people, they are very much interested to understand what is the Diversity Act. I know that it is very difficult to fit both these lectures, like the Act and PBR, in one single lecture. In the legal way, like as in section by section, but the Act in a very simplified manner, I'm trying to explain. India, as we know that India is with the rich in the biological diversity and associated traditional and contemporary knowledge. This is why I'm explaining is that because this is the main objective of the Biological Diversity Act. Biological Diversity Act is based on the CBD, like a convention of the biological diversity, and the principle which is accepted at the CBD is the conservation of biological diversity, sustainable use of its components, and fair and equitable sharing of the benefits based on the biological resources, genetical resources, knowledge, and matters connected therewith. Now, these are the three principles based on which the entire act has been designed. And selective people, they are aware about this act, even though it is established in 2002. So it is almost now 20 years has been passed, but still this act could not be reached to the last person who is an important component of this act. We'll just try to see what are the important features or the salient features of this act. The main feature is to regulate the access to biological resources of the country, equitable share in benefits arising out of its biological resources. Now, many people, they are getting confused. What does it mean? The meaning is very simple, although it's a very technical language. But I'll just would like to give one simple example. Suppose a person is a trader. So they are the local people or the local community, what you say. Now, the people, they are collecting the material from ground and they are selling it to the person who is a trader or a manufacturer of any drug. Now, people, how much they are getting? Take an example of Terminalia, Balarica, or the Chibula. Now, in this case, the people generally, this Chibula, every from many parts of Maharashtra, this Chibula fruits, the people they are collecting, and they are getting 100 rupees. Sometimes even the if it is very large in size, then they are getting 10 rupees per kg as such. But actually, when that product, that raw material reached to the manufacturer, the price of that product increases multiple times. And that we cannot imagine that how much time that is increasing. So major benefits goes to the trader or the manufacturer of the unit. So here, equitable share means the person who is actually taking care of the bioresources on ground, they also should get benefited based on the any business is based on that bioresource, or if anyone is using commercially that product, then they must get benefited because they are taking care of that resources on ground. So this is a principle, is equitable sharing of the benefits arising out of biological resources or genetical resources. Now, this resources actually till now, and this is a situation you might have heard about the case studies of the basmati rice, where the patent was awarded initially to the foreign company. Similarly, it is about the turmeric. Turmeric also patent was given. Later on, the fight began, and we successfully revoked both of these patents. But it took a lot of resources, financial and our human resource also. And later on, we realized that no, our traditional knowledge is with the immense important, and it can be patented by anyone if it is not registered with us. So registration is one of the important component of this act, and the provision has been made under this act for registration of the traditional knowledge associated with the biological diversity or the biological resources. And that's why the second objective of the act itself is the conserve and sustainable use of biological diversity. So there is no ban as such, but whatever utilization is been, it has to be sustainable manner. And who should do that? So it's a obviously there is a national level authority is called as National Biodiversity Authority is there. The head office of the NBA is in Chennai, and all the state do have their state biodiversity board. Under the state biodiversity board, there are the biodiversity management committee. So here we do have the three layer structure, that is at national level, state level, and ground level. So we'll just try to understand this structure in my next 2-3 slides. The important component or the main basic of this act is to respect and protect the knowledge of local communities, traditional knowledge related to the biodiversity. Here, protect knowledge of local community and traditional knowledge. These two things are very, very important. Now, we know that traditional knowledge, what does it mean by the traditional knowledge? Many a time, we don't know that how the traditional knowledge it is there, because the people also there don't know that this knowledge is immensely important. In one of the case study, I know that when I was working in the rural areas of the Kokan, one of the person, he was very much aware about how to make a oil. For their own hair treatment. Now that fellow was making that oil in somehow method by somehow the traditional methods, but this knowledge was not registered with anyone. Only that fellow and their family members were aware about that knowledge. One of the company men approached to him. They asked that, can you disclose the formula to them so they will pay the good amount for that knowledge. Now here the catch is, company generally pays only once when they are taking such knowledge, and after that the person is not getting benefited. But once the knowledge get registered, the patent share will goes to the person. This is mechanism is made under this act. So here respect and protect, these two things are very important to understand. Apart from that, this act is provided a number of, actually it's a very good tool for the conservation, those who are interested to do the conservation on ground, conservationists, researchers, and so many people, because it's giving the opportunity for us to protect the unprotected areas, community-based unprotected areas, where there is no legal legislation as such. For example, a biodiversity heritage site, that is a BHS. Now this heritage site, under this act, any area, there are actually number of characters are the the characteristics we need to define are based on the richness of the biodiversity, endemism of the biodiversity present to that area. That area can be declared as an biodiversity heritage site. The National Biodiversity Authority has already issued the guidelines to declare the biodiversity heritage site. And if you could go through that heritage site, all the details or the characteristics required for the declaration of heritage site, sites can be observed. So it's a major tool, like as in all the sacred groves. Now sacred groves in Maharashtra, in Maharashtra it is called as a Devrai, but in various states the names are different, and its type is also different. It's not only the forest. Sometimes it is the sacred pond, sometimes it is a sacred forest, sometimes it's sacred animals are also there into that. So based on the tradition and the cultural practices, the type and nature of the sacred sites are different. So but this is an important tool, and anyone can use that tool with the help of local community. Another provision is the protection and rehabilitation of the threatened species. Now, this can be done in association with the Biodiversity Management Committee. I'll speak about the BMC in latter part. Apart from that, the involvement of the committees or the constitution of the committee is a very, very important part. It's like as in we do have the forest department, but forest department have the rights to protect the forest which is belongs to the government, like as in government forest area. So people they are working for that area, but here the total, right? Like as in India do have the forest, 24% of forest we do have. In different state, the forest area might be different. But this is on an average 24% for forest present areas are there. So out of that, like almost 75% area is community or the revenue or the other people where the stakes of the local community is there. So this area comes under the Biodiversity Management Committee. So it's a, they are the managers of the biodiversity and they need to take care of that. And that's why the state government and other people needs to work with the Biodiversity Management Committee and strengthen the committees for doing the appropriate conservation under this act. We'll just try to understand what terms has been defined under the. I'm not going to describe all the terms, but we need to understand that there are certain terms which is not defined in under any other act, like as a benefit claimers, who called it as a benefit claimers. So it's actually the local holder, those who are the communities, those are holding that knowledge of the individual person who with whom the knowledge is there. Similarly, what does it mean by the biological resources? Sometimes we are using this word continuously, but we are not understanding exactly what does it mean. So it is well defined. Even it a bioresource includes the genetical resource, remember. So even a DNA is also, if the extracting the DNA and based on the DNA, if you are developing some or extracting the bioactive compounds or doing developing some any other drug or something like that. So even it also covered up under the biological resources. Similarly, other definitions are there, bioresources, biosurvey, bioutilization, commercial utilization. So here, very simple definition, end use of the bioresources, if it is used in commercial purposes or with the they are getting the benefit out of that, then it's a commercial. Similarly, fair and equitable benefit sharing. It's a well, actually, there is a separate government resolution for the same under the section 21. So we can get a separate GR for that, which is available on the NBS website. This act also defined what is the meaning of the research. All this you may be able to see under the section 2 of the act. What does it mean by the sustainable use? It's a component of the bioresource in such a manner that and at a such a rate it does not decline to the long term or to the long term decline of the biodiversity thereof. So here the important the person need to understand that the this is actually the function of the BMC. They need to see that whether the bioresources, when they are using the any bioresources, is the bioresources is getting declined or not. So this is a main function of the Biodiversity Management Committee, and that's why the sustainable use. If consider that any resource, if the people they are taking out in haphazardous manners, so if it is declining very fast, so even there is a procedure that they can revoke the permission for the access to the bioresources from that area. And the last one is the value added. There are some others are also there, but I have not added here all. Value added product. Now, value added product, why this is important? Because a value added product is not covered under the Biological Diversity Act. Once it becomes a value added product, then it goes out of the ambit of this act. So we need to understand that which part comes under the act and which part is not covered under the act. So all drugs, like the Ayurvedic drugs, they are a mixture of several other things. And here the definition is product which may contain portion or extract of plants or animal in unrecognizable and physically inseparable form. So when a drug or the powders are like in this manner, unrecognizable and physically inseparable form, so it's a mixture, more than 1, 2, 3, they are adding together and it becomes a mixture. And such product, then it goes out of the ambit of this act. So that's why the value added products is very, very important term. And we need to understand up to what extent the only the raw materials, bioresources are covered under this act. There are some important provision under this act. For example, section 3, this is in general, I'm explaining. Section 3 is the foreigner. So any foreigner, if visiting to India, and if he want to collect any bioresources. Now, any means even one single twig of flower or flowering plant, even if he want to collect for any purposes, then he needs to approach to the through the NBA and should get a appropriate permission under the Section 3. Why this stringent provision is there? So many a time it have, they are asking the question. Here, what they are accessing is very much important. Although I have given you the example of a tree or plant material, but you just consider that if they are accessing a water sample, it's just 1 to 2 ml, which contains the very important microorganisms from that area. And if they are taking out taking this microorganism to their country, so they can develop any commercial patent based on the bioresources available in our country. Now, this is under the CBD also, it is well defined that what are the resources available in the country, the rights are belongs to that country. It is very simple principle, it's accepted. And that's why any foreigners, when they are coming to India, they are not supposed to collect any bioresources from field. You want to access the bioresources or biological material, they must go through the Section 3 and appropriate permission from the NBA. Similarly, transfer of research results also. Suppose our Indian agency is doing some research and they want to transfer that research to the foreign country. But this is with important thing is that if it is having some commercial importance. Remember, here commercial is very, very, this term we need to understand. Commercial means it should be a sellable thing, and what are the patent, if it is generated, then some monetary gain will take place. So in such all such cases, this research transfer, they need to go through the National Biodiversity Authority at national level. So does it mean that the foreigners and research result, even every time they need to go? If you start the collaborative research project, like as in India, some of the universities are there, they are working with the Australian universities. So Australian researcher also can come to India and they can collect the material if the research projects are the collaborative type. Now, this collaboration needs to be registered with the NBA, and once it is get registered, so they can exchange the material also. So even for the, it's not many a time, this is a major objection for the BD Act, or they're saying that it's become very difficult to access the material, which is not true as such. There is a procedure, no doubt it takes some time. Now the days also has been fixed up for the same. Section 3 is for the application of the IPR and patent. This is our today's important part. Patent is based on the traditional knowledge with the people, specifically in the present case. The biodiversity related issue. How we'll identify whether the knowledge is with the people and community knows about the patent that I'm interested. I'm a Ayurvedic practitioner and I know that how to make a drug, and based on some formula or what are my understanding is there, if I'm preparing a new drug, but it's a mandatory for me to check it whether the traditional knowledge about that new new drug, the way that I have prepared, it is not with any community. So where is the source for this to understand or to check whether this knowledge is present or not? That is the People's Biodiversity Register. So this Section 3 is for the PBR is very, very important, and similarly it's for the community also. Section 3 is generally for all Indians, those who are interested, researchers and all these people, students, those who are interested to collect any material, or the industries also, those who are interested any material for the any production point of view, commercial point of view, they need to go through the Section 7. This is purely for the Indian people. Now, apart from that, other important provisions like Section 21 is the ABS mechanism, all those who are involved in the commercial utilization of the bioresources. BHS, as I said, that Section 37, traded commodity. Now, this Section 40 is explaining that all bioresources, there is no need to have a permission for the all bioresources. For example, you are the farmers, they are producing the rice. So even they want to sell the rice into the market, but how they will go to that? If it is that, or any, it is also the part of the biological diversity, and it is also the one of the bioresource. So will they need to take a permission? So it was this all such type of things we need to understand very carefully. So because of all these things, now there is a commodity. This is all considered as a commodity. So how many commodities are there? So NBS has defined, our government of India has defined that how many commodities are there for which there is no need to have a permission under the Biological Diversity Act. So this traded commodity, it's well defined, like as in, it's not an entire plant as such, but they are defined that whether its root is exempted, its fruit is exempted, leaves are exempted, or entire plant is exempted. Like that, part by part, you will get the details about the traded commodity, and that traded commodity, the government can add some new species to the traded commodity, or even they can take out some of the commodities from that. So initially it was declared in 2009, then it was updated later on, and now recently 2015, the GR is available where they are enlisted all the traded commodities in India. Section 41 deals with the BMC formation and how, what is their role and how to do that thing, that is well defined under the section 41. And last one is the section 55, the penalties. Here penalties, if you look at the penalties under the BD Act and the penalties under the other Forest Act, you will realize that this act is more stringent than even the Indian Forest Act, the Indian Conservation Act, where the fine is hardly 500 or maximum to the 2000 rupees. But here under the Biodiversity Act, the minimum fine is rupees 1 lakh for anyone in any violation. And another issue is that it's a non-bailable act. It's a very stringent provision. Unfortunately, this provision has been not used, or it is still underutilized by the implementer for this act. We'll just try to understand Biodiversity Management Committee in brief, and then we'll go towards the PBR. This Biodiversity Management Committee, it's actually the institution at the local state government, and required to the local state government required to set up these committees for the conservation, sustainable use, and documentation of the biodiversity. Here NBA actually the NBA and State Biodiversity Board, SBB stands for the State Biodiversity Board, they are supposed to consult BMC for the matters related to use of the bioresources. So whatever the area of that village or the gram panchayat it is there, the jurisdiction of the gram panchayat, that entire the biodiversity present within that jurisdiction needs to be taken care of by the Biodiversity Management Committee. So anything, if it is coming to that area or projects or any other thing, the actually government should do the consultation with the Biodiversity Management Committee. So that's why I said that it's a three-layer structure: National Biodiversity Authority, State Biodiversity Authority, and then directly there is a Biodiversity Management Committee. So BMC has got immense rights under the Biodiversity Act. Unfortunately, they are not using their rights in appropriate manner, or they are still the BMC's structure itself is not very much strong in several areas. What is the structure? It is it's a member nominated by the Gram Sabha or the local body. It's not from the elected body, remember. It's a nominated. So it's a Gram Sabha to have the rights to elect their 7 members, and they are calling as a local knowledgeable person. Now this local knowledgeable person, in which sector, that also I'll explain in my next slide. But apart from that, to manage the biodiversity, it is a management committee to manage. They should get a person from the forest department, agriculture, livestock, fisheries, education, or tribal department. Now these are all invitees. So invitees means it's not necessary all the invitees should be there. So committee basically is up to 7 people only. Once the 7 people is there, the committee is formed. But additional, for their support and guidance, they need additional members and chairman amongst the members. In Maharashtra now, the there is a little bit change or amendment has been done. Now chairman is a sarpanch, that is who is the head of the Gram Sabha. He is the by default person chairman of the biodiversity management committee. Now this is the who should be the local knowledgeable person. Either he should be the herbalist, agriculturist, NTFP collector or the trader, fisher folk, representative of user association, community folk, community worker, academician or engineer. So from these different fields, there are 7 people should be there, and there is also the condition that to not less than 18% women should be there, SCST the percentage should be there, and all these things, the conditions are already defined under the Act. But these are, this local knowledgeable person should be there in the Biodiversity Management Committee. Now, these people, like as in fisher folk, if you ask them, fisher folk person, if they are the traditional fisher folk, then they will let you know the several things, that which fish is now decreasing, which fish is increasing, which fish is coming new to that area, and how the biodiversity present within that river ecosystem or the pond ecosystem is under change, so and so on. But we need to understand, or we need to talk with the person in that way. Because if just general, if we ask the general question to them, then this traditional knowledge associated with the fishing and other related areas, it will never come out. So all this, it requires a lot of discussion with the community in group also. And that's why we need to have the representative from all these areas in the BMC itself. In addition to that, BMC can also invite the MLAs or MPs for their meetings, and it should be constituted at all local body level, that is the Gram Panchayat, but above the block level, then district level. So wherever the election is generally taking place, local body has been well defined. So at all that level, the Biodiversity Management Committee, it is necessary to be there. To support the BMC, there is a technical support group also should be there. Now, this THG should be established by the state biodiversity, respective state biodiversity board. And that THG involves the experts from the biodiversity, from agencies, NGOs, academic fields, communities, and so on and so on. So these THGs generally helping the biodiversity management committee for the identification and technical knowledge or technical names of the species observed in their area. What is the main function of the BMC? It is their main first major function is the comprehensive people's biodiversity register. It is a apostrophe as people's. So whatever the people, if there's an understanding or the knowledge of the people is there, only that much part we are expecting very strongly in this register. Initially or the long back, the same register used to call as a community register. So different names were there, but now it is well accepted that it's a people's biodiversity register. And based on their own biodiversity information to that area, they are supposed to advise the state biodiversity board or even the NBA on any matter if it is referred by them to the biodiversity management committee. So they have the say, direct say at ground level, whether what type of biodiversity it is there and what is to be do, what is to be done, like as an the new project and other, when it is coming, they must get a chance to express their views in front of the committees, or the consultation has to be done with the biodiversity management committee. Even they have the rights to regulate the access to bioresources to the outside agencies and individuals. Suppose if any outsider is coming to the village and accessing the bioresources, they are supposed to pay the levy, whatever decided by the biodiversity management committee. So BMC do have that right to take the fees, and it is they must issue the receipt for the same, but that fund goes to the biodiversity management committee's for account, or it is also called as local biodiversity fund. So now we are coming back or we'll come move towards the PBR, which is our main intention today. PBR stands for the People's Biodiversity Name. What is that? So it is the information with the people, community about the biodiversity in their area. What type of biodiversity it is there? And that's mainly the which include the traditional knowledge associated with the wild species as well as agricultural species. So it's a not only the species related thing, but it's about also the utilization, how they are using it. Several times they are also not aware about that, the what are the traditional knowledge that to have, how much it is important. For example, look at the photograph. They are covering that roof with grasses. Now here also their traditional knowledge is associated. The way that they are weaving that grasses and they are putting the bamboos and even the which type of grass is supposed to be used to make this small houses or the small shelter home-like structure in their agriculture field, that also involves a lot of traditional knowledge. And this is purely the environmental or the pro-environmental thing. Now, generally, this type of knowledge, people know that, are aisa hota hai, waisa hota hai, but they are not putting the everything on the record. But under the PBR, it is expected to document all such type of things, which is even it is a minor important, but it has to be there in this document. This PBR, it contains information about the diversity in agriculture, marine diversity, information about the community, water source, soil and landscape. We may not get all people who is good with the water source, soils and landscape, but there are some of the people, like as in one block, you will certainly get that the person who knows how to take out the water from ground. Now, they do have their own traditional methods, but we know that several methods is never been documented. I'm not saying that whether all methods are correct or valid or not valid, that is not the point of the discussion. We need to validate that. We need to discuss about their methods with some of the experts in that field. But documentation of this people, okay, this person is there and he knows a lot of things about the water. That documentation needs to be done at a ground level. So species using by human beings, plants and animals, biodiversity around their houses, areas, about the wild species. So many, there is generally, we are getting a lot of information about the wild species, wild medicinal plant also. And in some of the species they use for very different purposes also. So all such information we may able to get it once we start discussing with the people about this availability of the species from their area. And last one is the economically important species. So people generally sharing their information about about the species which they are generally using it frequently. Take an example of the grass. If some of the grass species, if they are important for the milking of the cows and other animal, so they will let you know the exact name of that species and where you where the species is getting, how much distribution is there. No doubt it will be in the local local language, but whenever they are using the species, they do have the general all the information about the species, and their observations are very keen. This is my experience. But over the period of time, like as an old generation, what are the knowledge the old generation they do have, now it has not been transferred. We can see that gap very clearly if you ask the question, the same PBR, during documentation of the PBR to the old people and to the new generation, then this difference generally we can see very immediately that, okay, older people, they know a lot of things as compared to that our new generation, they do not have this information up to that extent. Why need the PBR? This is so many people are asking the question, because recently there was order by the NGT also to complete the PBR of all villages till February 30 or 28th February. So many people ask me also why we need to do this PBR urgently. So here it's a main part is it's not for government of India or for any other state government also. It is for villager themselves. So it's a related with the ecosystem services. It is related with their own development, that biodiversity based own development in the village itself. So it's a for the documentation of all available species. Available species means several species they might have lost also, But so what is left? That is important. And to document traditional knowledge, as I already explained. So no one else should claim that this knowledge belongs to them, or they should not take a patent on that. That's why whatever existing knowledge is there, it needs to be recorded. Total resources available to that. So some of the villages, they do have very good power, or they can sell out some of the resources, like in Vidarbha area, every year Tendu leaves selling in very large amount. So it's a big bioresource. So what are the other bioresources or the major bioresources available to that area? What type of the traditional varieties is available to their area and the people they are using it? Now, this is also important because many seed companies, they need the information about the traditional varieties. Generally, they are using the traditional varieties for breeding purposes. But before taking that seed from any rural area or from any community or the person individual, they need to take a permission, appropriate permission from the state biodiversity board, because it's a commercial utilization. So after developing any new variety, whatever the benefits they are generating out of that, that must get shared with the person or the community or that area from where this variety, basic variety, has been procured. For that, this needs to be documented. To understand the quantity bioresources available in the villages and to dependency of the local people and the natural bioresources. Sometimes it happened that there is a good forest is there, but dependency because of several other developmental processes, now it has been reduced. That also the issue is there. Or like as in Maharashtra, or in many part of the western part, or the in the northeast part of the India, the dependency on the forest is too much. Because they are totally dependent on the forest areas. So how much they are dependent, that is also needs to understand, because it will help to develop the management plan of the bioresources based on the information given in the People Biodiversity Register. Certain questions are there. So that's why I just tried to put the question in a very simplest manner. That is, the who will develop the PBR? It's no one else than the Biodiversity Management Committee. It's a first and foremost duty of the Biodiversity Management Committee. And why they should develop? Because if they want to register their knowledge to get the benefit out of commercial access and PBR, but apart from that, to develop the Biodiversity Management Plan based on the bioresources available, because they're supposed to use all the bioresources in sustainable manner. And what is the source of funding? The State Biodiversity Board in association with NBA. And apart from that, the BMC also can raise their own funding by filling the bioresources in sustainable manner. And also they can accept the grants, they can raise the project, they can take the donation. So this, all these things is mentioned in the Biodiversity Act. So these are some of the important facts of the PBR. Who will authorize the PBR? This is another issue. That okay, when you say that the PBR is now over, this has been done. Actually, the Biodiversity Management Committee itself, they should say that yes, now our information is completed and this is our final PBR. But before to that, once your information has been collected, then the State Biodiversity Board needs to appoint a technical support group or committee to validate the knowledge. Here the process of the validation is involved. Why the validation is involved? Because there you may get that under the name of the traditional knowledge, several types of the invalid information also. So come out of that all things, only the good scientific information or the which having the scientific background, that should be get registered into the PBR. So this technical support committee will do that analysis of the information collected. And another one is that they will provide you the scientific name of the species from that area. Because based on the scientific name only, the linkages of the PBR with the national register can be possible. Otherwise, it is not possible. So this committee generally giving the suggestion, okay, what type of changes is required in the PBR. Accordingly, the BMC has to accept and they do need to develop that. And finally, the BMC has to say that, yes, this is finally done and need to submit the PBR officially to the State Biodiversity Board. And this Technical support group involves the renowned taxonomists, botany, zoology, Ayurvedic practitioners also, because they know what are the traditional practices in the Ayurveda. So experts of the traditional knowledge. So this can be varied, no doubt. It based on the ground situation also, in which area, what type of knowledge is available and how much dependency is. As much as dependency is more, we may need a more expert into the technical support group. That is a simple way. Another thing is that what will be the status of the information here? Generally all information in the PBR is a confidential one. It's an individual, it involves the intellectual property right acts also. The information is of the people, so it needs to be protected. So under the IPR, this is their own individual right sometimes, or sometimes it is the community right. So it must go in their own name. So all this information, which is generally we are writing in the PBR, that must keep confidential, and that is the main other function of the Biodiversity Management Committee. Even the it is a binding to all the organization or individuals, those who are involved in the PBR development, they must keep the secrecy of the PBR information. Otherwise, those people can misuse the information if it is not get protected. And what is the prime goal? It is to restrict based here this information. If it is the traditional information is really good, then it will help to restrict the foreign agencies to obtain the patent. Although I said that foreign agency, but it involves the local people also. If somebody is want to take a patent on the any new formula of the Ayurvedic medicine, then he also needs to go through the State Biodiversity Board and NBA so that whatever the information has been provided by that fellow, it will generally get cross-checked with the PBR information available with the board. So this is to restrict the patent issue. This is the one thing to assure the sustainable utilization of the available bioresources. So what are the resources available, whether it is they are collecting in destructive manner or in sustainable manner? This is another issue, because every year the people can say that yes, once upon a time these plants, they were very they were in very large number, this plant was there, but now we lost all that there. So this type of information easily can be collected during the PBR documentation. Another issue is the sharing the to share the benefit arising out of the commercial utilization. So if somebody is using the this resources for the commercial purposes, then surely BMC needs to file the case with the state board. No, this is they are using it commercially, and you need to go through the state biodiversity board so that to whatever the benefits the person will get, it must get back to the village as per the provisions of the act. Here, one more. Actually, there are several examples, but as the time constraint is there, I cannot explain a lot. But if time permits, I'll explain some of them later on. There are NBAs defined. There are 32 formats. It also involved the marine formats, and this recorded in the names of the individual. This is very the last column is the who has holding that knowledge, whether it is a community or the individual person. This is important. And the state biodiversity board supposed to give the training to the villagers through the various agency, because they cannot do all the things. But no doubt there are several NGOs experts. They are working in several parts of country, and they're supposed to give the training how to develop the PBR. All the format, there are 32 format, but I have just roughly segregated the formats in five groups. Six formats are related with the agricultural diversity. Man-made diversity, there are nine formats. The man-made means it's a planted by the human being. Even it comes the gardens around their houses also, it comes, I call it orchards specifically, and other what are the garden varieties or the varieties brought for different purposes. It comes under the man-made variety. Wild variety diversity, there are 10 different formats. So fish, including fish species, flora, fauna, medicinal plant, aquatic animals, so on and so on. So there are 10 different formats. people, land, water, and soil. So there are the just to peoplescape, about the land, about the water, understanding about the soil. So there are four different formats. And in urban areas, generally we are not getting the traditional information or linkages. But for that, just enlisting of the flora and fauna is expected. So for that, the two more formats are there. In case of the marine diversity, there are A and B form is there, where A is for the floristic diversity and B is for the faunal diversity. So like that, there are 32 formats, including A and B of the marine diversity. It's given by the NBA. But remember that all the formats, the last format, the 31st format, it says about any additional information. So sometimes you may get some information is not fitting to the first 30 formats. So we do have the 31st format where all other information can be, we can write that information, which cannot be fit into in this category. So people need to take a decision according to that where to write. But these formats are also good format. We are expecting to collect a comprehensive information, and comprehensive generally in one shot it is not possible. Generally it requires the versions, like then first time, second time, third time. So PBR itself is a very dynamic document. It's not a static one. So if it is a dynamic, it can be updated after 1 year, 2 year, or the if somebody feels that after submitting of the PBR, this is new information, is not been recorded previously. So such new information also can be recorded later on. And then that, after getting such information, again, that PBR submission needs to be done by the respective BMC to the State Biodiversity Board to update the knowledge with the State Biodiversity Board also. This is one of the formats. I'm not going to display all the formats, but I would like to pinpoint column number 10, 11, and 12. Here, column number 10 explains, is asking about the usage. So this usage is not general usage. For what purpose the people there, they are using that particular species? What is the in what way also? So this is associated traditional knowledge you may able to document about the species and the practice with that. So this column number 10, 11 and 12 also, so this 10, 11 and 12, all this information are also about the 8, that is the special feature of this. This is their personal information, and this personal information must keep confidential. When I was working with some tribal groups, so I realized that these tribal people, they know some of the species in means how to extract the specific part from that seed, or generally all part of the seed is not edible. So only some part is edible. So how to get that part out, and why they are interested, so and so on. Like then gums also, information about the gums, extraction of the gums from the trees, and so on and so on. So this type of things are there, but all this, their traditional knowledge is a confidential part. And that's why these columns are covered under the IPR also. And that's why you look at the column number 14, community knowledge holder. Who has shared that knowledge, that name must be there at the end. Although I have explained only the one single form, but similar type of columns you may able to see in rest of the form, which is related to species collection. So that's why I just tried to explain only one form. Here the scientific name, column number 2, generally this column is filled up by the technical support group, and column number 7, local status, past and present. So there are several cases like that. Past it was available in plenty, but now it is reduced. In past it was not there, but it is now. It means that it is a new species. Past we had that species, but now we do not have, means we lost that species. So several conclusions can be taken out based on the information provided by the species under the column number 7 also. So this is very interesting to analyze the data given by the people in different formats. There are 6 stages in the PBR development. The first and foremost is that before starting the PBR, one should have a BMC, Biodiversity Management Committee. Without the BMC, PBR cannot be approved. Several NGOs, like as a, before the act also in Maharashtra, PBR community registers were done. But now we asked all of them that, okay, can you just go through that, the your own community registered again and submit as in your own, with the approval of the BMC as an PBR. So PBR previously documented knowledge, if you want to make it valid, it has to be done to the BMC. So establishment of the BMC is very, very important. And that BMC should submit the PBR officially. Whenever PBR starts, the awareness among the people is very, very important. Without making any awareness, people never shares the information. Even though any NGOs they are working, I had that experience now recently. The lot of PBR has been done throughout India, and that's why. So whenever agency went to the villages, they realized that people are not ready to share the information. They said that, who are you? Why you need this information? So all these questions generally raised if somebody starts PBR development directly. But instead of that, if you are, they could make the awareness among the people, then people start giving a lot of information about it. Next part is the training. Once you've done with the awareness, the PBR, to whom the training is required, not to the all villagers. It is training is required to the members of the BMC, those who are going to, they will take part of the PBR development, and the person who is going to write that document. The writing, the person who is going to ask the question, these two person required a lot of training, that what type of question they should ask, how they should ask, how to get the information. So all such type of training is required. And after that, data collection in different season, verification of the data from technical group, and finalization of PBR by BMC. And last one is computerization of the. So these are the six stages PBR development is required. There are several taxonomies in India and different states also. So they have the major role to play in the PBR development. They need to give the services for the identification, distribution, population dynamics of the species, knowledge validation, because generally people are explaining a lot of species, but accurate name of the species needs to be written into the PBR document. And there is a lot of gap in with it. PBR is there, but generally many PBR is without the scientific name. Now such without scientific names, we cannot link up this PBR with the national database. And that's why the taxonomists or academicians do have the major role in the PBR development. Where the application of the PBR is there. First one is the biodiversity management plan. It's a very unfortunate that the people is not looking toward developing this, the management plan. Forest department do have very nice management plan. But now villages themselves, they can develop the biodiversity management plan. Okay, this is my yearly requirement of the bioresources from that area. And so how we can do that? Some of the villages, no doubt, they did extraordinary work and they able to develop their own management plan as such. And this plan can be also incorporated into the forest management plan also, remember. So the independence of the biodiversity management committee is essential in that. And that's why the PBR documentation is the first step towards that. It also explains you the how many threatened species are present to that area. Same document, it's a forest, for forest there are PBR is through the JFMC's Varna Samiti. There are several other committees in PESA and FRA. These two acts are also there, and under that a lot of rights has been given by the government to their committees. But although, even though they are getting their rights under their respective acts, but they need to develop the PBR to get the ABS mechanism. And that's why this PBR is also applicable for them, and that is also important for the forest management committee. Conservation, pure conservation declaration of BHS and threatened species in agricultural field also, the traditional crop varieties, wild relatives of the crop species, these two things are different, and how the changes has been taken. Specifically, I would like to quote here that about the invasive species coming or the pests on large scale into the agriculture area. Several new things are coming up, and people need to record these things in their PBR. This pest is first time we are observing, and there are some records like that. And this is the worrisome thing. So PBR is not only the just to write something their traditional knowledge, but it is to understand that yes, people are also understanding the impact of the climate change and their according to that what type of changes is taking place in the agricultural sector also. Social aspect, like as ecosystem services, although this word it's very difficult to understand to all people, but they know that they are getting the water. It's a major services from their nearby areas. So although this just apart from the technical word, people understand the ecosystem services, its availability from the area, and like as in riverine area also, origin of the rivers in several areas it is there. So PBR also involves the documentation of all such resources from their area, and that's why in social aspect also it's having a lot of application. Economic development, biological resource map they can develop. Some of the organizations they are already working for that. It's a baseline document also. It can be used in the environment impact assessment. Actually, the several other agencies they are making the EIS, but if the BMC do have their own report, so this can be directly go to the EIS if it is if they think that it is fit to that. So this is another view that economic development purposes also it can be used in very different manner. They can also regulate the commercial utilization of bioresources. They can also go for the payments for ecosystem services. This payment for ecosystem services just recently started. It's not been done. It's completely. But no doubt, they can think for that and integration of the ecotourism. All this thing can be done based on the PBR data. The PBR is also useful for the industry because from where the resources are available, so they can, the industry requires the resources, so it's a good market. So from where they can get the material, and there are several industries, they are ready to pay the ABS. Okay, we are ready to pay the ABS, just give us the some good amount of the material from this area. So this PBR, once it is documented in nice way, then it can be, or even the board or other committee themselves, they can say that yes, next year we may able to get this much material from our area. I think that I'll just cover within 2-3 minutes. In technical support group, as I explained, there is a major role of the technical support group is to identify the species and do the validation of the species. There are several experts needs for the all this, like an angiosperm expert, some orchid, grasses. So it based on the which area your PBR, you are doing the PBR. Like as in, suppose if you are doing the PBR of the Amboli is the, itself is a key biodiversity area. And if it is that much is the key biodiversity area, then you may need good experts to understand what type of, how many different species are present to that, and so on and so on. So I'll just now really go ahead with the technical support group. There is a gap in between the traditional knowledge and scientific knowledge. Traditional knowledge is generally in local language and is never converted to the scientific knowledge with their names. This is the major gap. And so there is no government record also traditional knowledge for regarding or the biodiversity at the village level. Rich knowledgeable people without science background and several scientific words in the name the scientists. But very few cases, the credit has been given to the information on. So you look at all the papers about ethnobotany. So ethnobotany, you will find that those who have shared the information, acknowledgement is to them. But actually, they are the author of the papers. So this is what the pretty thing is there. So now at least the PPR is the document where the information will get registered on the name of the local knowledgeable person. So it's a linkage also, the PBR is a teach, PBR is a tool rather, to teach the students about the conservation biology, species identification, documentation, services, cultural ecology, natural resource management, habitat, so many things are there, and PRS studies also. So this can be used very effective manner. It's an open source for the academician. So here the students can get involved. Biodiversity database generally it's a developing and ecological processes. So enlisting of the species from village, district, and block level. So assemblage of the species is expected to do in that manner. Really, there are some no doubt that the challenges are also there. That availability of the proper authentic taxonomies in different areas. The understanding rights about the people. In different parts of the India, this situation is very different. Linkages, how they are linked, like then the rights about of the local people with the sacred groves and the way that they are working with the sacred groves or the conserving the sacred groves. So this is not very straightforward. We need to understand or we need to ask them in different ways so that all the link, what are the information or the traditional link with the sacred growth, it can be documented in proper manner. I think that this is my second last slide. PBR is not a scientific paper. So those who are working in the scientific community, they need to understand that it's not a scientific paper. It is the confidential document of the local people. And without permission of the BMC, it is not allowed to publish any record related to their IPR issues given in the PBR. Remember, there is no restriction in publication of any flora or fauna or the species list. Nothing is there. So anyone can publish that thing. I'm not saying about that. I'm talking about the individual knowledge about the people related to the biodiversity to the area. So these three points are very much important. And this is the present status of the PBR. Recently, because of the Supreme Court, that NGT's order, the number has increased significantly. From 29 states, almost 119,000 PBR has been done. UP is already completed 59,000. Maharashtra, 21,000. So this is the recent updates from the National Biodiversity website. And this is just, I want to say that the climate change is in process, understand its implication with the biodiversity in villages. PBR is the best process for understanding our cultural practices for conservation and restoration. So we need to think that manage everything which is unavoidable in process and avoid everything which is unmanageable. So thank you very much. I think that if you have the questions, we'll just try. I don't know how much time is left. So I'll just hand over it to the Viraj. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for the session. We have few questions. So, yeah. How would you like to go? Like, should I read the question or you would?
You read a question, so I'll just answer.
Okay, fine. So, the first question is, please provide the details of training centers related to PBR development.
Oh, actually, state biodiversity board should raise that training center. Even the BNHS from my side also. Now we conducted 1 month program, entire 1 month program only for PBR development. And Mr. Nandakumar Dude, who is now coordinating the NVIS under the BNHS, he is the person who will give you all the details about such type of courses. Whenever we'll launch the PBR training course, we'll let you know. But for that, you can be in touch with the BNHS or you can directly contact to the State Biodiversity Board whether they are organizing any training program for this or not. Or there are several NGOs are also there, those who are doing it independently.
Okay. So the next question is from Gusku Ram. He is saying, according to Section 41 of the Biodiversity Act 2002, every local body has a provision to create a BMC. Cities mostly have ornamental vegetation. In this case, whether or not the ornamental flora should be documented in PBR?
I think I explained. There is a format number 30, where the urban areas, there is no traditional knowledge linked with the biodiversity. So, because most of the people there from the outsiders, they are there. But for that, there is the formats are very simple. Yes, there is need to enlist that how many species are present. So, name of the particular species and multiples of them.
Now tree authority, all the municipal council and corporations do have the tree authority. So under the tree authority, it is their mandate to document all tree diversity in their jurisdiction. So this information itself, or it can be directly documented into the PBR also, but they are documenting only the information which is along the roadside, not about the species available in people's premises. So this is like then data sciences or the community based sciences structure. So you need to ask the people that can you put this record that which type of species you do have in urban area. So again, the awareness part is there. So people will give the information as that, okay, we do have this type of species and in my garden, and like that you need to develop the or you need to enlist the number of species present in urban areas. But no doubt there is no traditional information is linked into the urban area.
Okay. Next question.
One more point. Here, this information is very much important for the city biodiversity index. In Hyderabad, city has developed the city biodiversity index. There are 24 parameters. And in that 24 parameters, this documentation of the biodiversity is, there is actually all this information is, you can put into that 24 parameters. And based on that, you can calculate the city biodiversity index. And that is now the one of the parameters considered for the smart city also. So remember, sustainable cities, under the sustainable city, now the biodiversity index is playing a key important role. Yes, next.
Okay, if a species of medicinal plant from wild forest, which is endemic, is to be cultivated and commercially produced in the farms, what kind of permissions are needed?
For cultivation, there is no need to permission as such, but whenever you are accessing, first time you are collecting the species from forest area, you need to go through the state biodiversity board's form. Now, there are different forms for, because rules for the East State Biodiversity Board is little bit different. Like in the Maharashtra, we do have the rules of 2008. Like that Punjab, they have the recent rules like that. So you just go through your rules of the State Biodiversity Board. Under that, you will get the Form A, where how you can access the bioresources from the State Biodiversity Board. So there is a declaration is there, and you need to give in declaration for what purposes you are collecting the species. If you start cultivating, because once it becomes a commodity, because under the traded commodity, which species you are selecting, that is important. Suppose that species is aloe vera, and if that aloe vera species, it is there, and the leaves are is a traded commodity, if it is mentioned into the traded commodity list, then in that case, once you collect that and produce, and if you even the sell it out in the market, there is no need to take the permission for that from the state biodiversity board. It based on that whether it is a commodity or when from where you are collecting the species. These two things are important.
Okay, so I'm seeing a lot of questions, but we'll take I guess only few of them now since we are running short of time. So, how can BDA be incorporated with Forest Rights Act?
That's very great. Under the Forest Rights Act, many people, they are thinking that, I'm also in that dilemma initially, that Forest Rights Act, once FRA is instituted, then the rights will go to the people, and then how will it do that? But rather, there are two types of the rights under the Forest Rights Act. One is individual rights, it is related to the cultivation for the crops in that area, and second one is the community rights. That FRA, when we are talking about that, they are getting the rights about the collection of the NTFPs from their areas, remember, or the bioresources. It's not only the infrastructure, also it is there. So these bioresources, they are getting the rights. That is what under the FRA is. But once they are getting the rights, where they are selling it? Once they are saying, because all the Vaidus and the local people, those are the actually dependent on the bioresources, they are exempted from the act. But the trader who is purchasing this bioresources from the tribal or any person in the village, they are under the ambit of this act. So for FRA also, they need to register how much resources they are collecting from their area, and they need to document it to the BMC's register, because once they registered with the BMC, the maintenance record into that, and after that, that if trader is purchasing that, then trader is, it's a mandatory to the trader to disclose that later on. It no doubt there a tripartite agreement is there. That agreement takes place in between the that village BMC, that trader or the manufacturer or and the cadastral board. So that tripartite agreement, once it is formed, then start the flowing of benefits. Those actually the trader and the other further the person they are getting it, that benefit flows down back to the BMC through the state cadastral board. So FRA to get that benefit, they need the BMC, and through the BMC they may get out that benefit.
Okay, so due to time constraint, we have to stop here now. We have provided you the with our email IDs, and contact number is also visible. So you may contact the speaker as per your convenience. And I would like to thank our speaker, Dr. Rahul sir, for today's session. And thank you all for attending this webinar. And have a good night. Thank you. I would now like to conclude this session. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Yeah.